Step up, step up. Who among you is not ready for a tale of high adventure, mythical creatures, and the most amazing man you'll ever meet? Yes, it is I, Dr. Elphias Mecurio, inviting you to step up, madames and messieurs, my dominant heron, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Dr. Mecurio's Mythical Marvels and Traveling Menagerie.
Really? I must speak to the caretaker about the condition of these graves. What am I paying him for? Oh, wait. I left without paying him when last we spoke. Oh, well, I'll just have Percy tidy up before we go. Hello, mother? Grandfathers? Father? Everyone's still dead, I see. Well, then, as we Mecurios are men of few words, not a peep, mother, I'll get right to the point. I have decided to expand the family business by starting a traveling menagerie and then, of course, slowly phase out the sale of Red Dragon Tonic. Oh, you're most likely thinking that he squandered the family fortune and now he's tossing the family tradition right down the loo after it. But times have changed, my dear family. You just can't go around bilking the public with a panacea whose main ingredient is slightly toxic. Besides, this will not be your average traveling circus, as I have dragons. Yes, Father, I am aware that dragons disappeared before I was born, but I have discovered the secrets of the alchemist legend. I already have two, and plans are in motion to retain two more. And who's to say that I have to stop with just dragons? Improbable is such an amazing place, and is full of strange wonders and incredible beasts. And I plan to do what all Mecurios have done since time immemorial. When one is presented with such an opportunity, exploit said opportunity to the fullest extent possible for scads of cash. And that, my dear deceased ancestors, is the true nature of the family business. Now, if you'll excuse me, I must be going. But rest assured, I will succeed. And in doing so, accomplishing something no Mecurio has ever done before. That's right, Father, I plan to cheat the Reaper.
At five bells, we all met for a wonderful dinner in the dining hall. It was nice to have a decent supper after spending the last 5 months aboard the moon. After everyone had had their fill, except for Precious, of course, who was busy chewing on a rusted suit of armor like a puppy with a shoe, the doctor laid out the plan for tomorrow's performance at the bazaar. Mecurio and Sprocket would present Precious, showing the crowd how a little red dragon tonic was perfect for calming down a rambunctious baby dragon. Percy and I would be in charge of showing the crowd my pretty Ping Ping and the few tricks that I had taught her during my off-duty hours. It had been a while since we had poisoned anyone on Middleof, so Mecurio was hoping to liquidate a few cases of red dragon tonic as well. Sadie would set out for her mother's compound, located on the other side of Middleof, to see if her ma still had the yeti fur and what she'd be willing to take for it. It was a simple plan, but as always...
Step up, madames and messieurs, my dominant heron, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to Dr. Mecurio's Mythical Marvels and Traveling Beastery. I, the most amazing and humble Dr. Elphias Mecurio, have spared no expense and have gone through terrifying peril to bring these mythical marvels for you to be astounded by. Be prepared to be astonished as my beasties were thought to be extinct for hundreds of years, but I can assure you that each and every specimen you see is 100% alive and breathing. I must caution those of you who are faint of heart or delicate of stomach that these creatures are vicious to a fault and held at bay by the calming yet restorative powers of the most potent, powerful panacea of our time, Dr. Mecurio's Red Dragon Tonic. Now, if you'd like, those of you who dare, you may step forward and examine this nasty beastie a little closer. This is the mighty Incendric. Although she prefers to be called Precious, don't you dare. Now, for those with a zoological interest, Incendric
what precious, is a Romanian rockworm. They can be found only in the highest peaks of the Carpathian Mountains and have been known to lay waste to castles, keeps, and entire villages. But as you'll see, just one dose of Mecurio's Red Dragon Tonic will make her as gentle as a one-ton puppy. Observe! And witness! Why, just if one bottle is enough to soothe this savage beast, imagine just what one thimbleful of this miracle medicine will do to soothe a croupy child off a frazzled nerve. By now you're saying to yourselves, where can I get this relaxing, restful remedy fit for man and beast for my own myriad of ailments? Well, before I tell you the source of this wonder of modern science, allow me a few more moments to show you the rarest jewel in my collection. From the northernmost reaches of the mysterious continent of China, a living conundrum, a squirming contradiction born of fire and breather of ice, the Chinese Frost Dragon, presented by our own Primrose Twins. Ladies and gents, Penelope and Percy Primrose.
Ladies and gents, meet Pickling. And she's, as the good doctor said, a Chinese Frost Dragon. Never has there been a more puzzling beastie in all creation. Like all dragons, she was born in fire, and hot coals and soot make up a third of her diet. But she prefers to nest in ice and the cold.
I was gonna tell him that part.
Don't be a baby, Percy. You can tell them the next bit.
The next bit of what?
The next bit about the dragon.
What dragon? Ow! Oh, yes. Well then, Ping Ping is also capable of flight. You see, Ping, you're an eastern dragon. And much like a bovine creature...
That's a cow.
I was gonna say that, Penelope.
Sorry.
As I was saying, eastern dragons have 14 stomachs.
Didn't mean to interrupt.
Eastern dragons have 14 stomachs. The first stomach actually roasts the dragon's meal and inflates the other 13 stomachs with a type of methane gas.
Methane is a fancy word for fog.
Penelope, and much like a dirigible, allows her to float. Once up, she undulates her serpentine body to propel herself through the skies like a floating serpent.
She's also the oldest of our pets. Amazingly, it takes the eastern dragons 1,000 years to reach maturity. And the same thing that keeps them young is a key ingredient in Dr. Mecurio's Red Dragon Tonic. Use it as a facial to erase wrinkles and worry lines, or add a drop to the tea kettle to give the whole family a feeling of vim and vigor. And a drop in a glass of warm milk will help you sleep like a baby. Dr. Mecurio's Red Dragon Tonic. Is there nothing it won't do?
And now the time has come for me to tell you how you can get a bottle of this amazing panacea for yourself. Let me ask you a question first, though. How much would you pay for a cure-all of this magnitude? 100? 1,000? 1,000,000 pieces of gold? What if I told you that each and every one of you can receive this phenomenal medicine absolutely scot-free? How does that sound? Yes, well, just a small donation of gold to keep our pets fed and our ship afloat, we will turn over to you one bottle of Dr. Mecurio's Red Dragon Tonic. Now, I know that some of you don't have two coppers to rub together, but not to worry, as we believe in sharing this serum with those of you who are less fortunate. That is why we also accept family heirlooms, deeds of trust, and anything of value as a donation as well. So step up, my dear friends, who will be the first of you to try this wondrous tonic?
Never in all my years with the doctor had I seen such a rush to purchase our tonic. Even more popular were our baby dragons, who rolled on their backs like playful kittens, people throwing gold in the hat just to pet them, enjoying the attentions of the crowd. Yes, it was all going to plan, until...
I thought you were warned about selling this swill at the bazaar, Mecurio.
If ever there existed a more irritating excuse for an elected official, they would pale in comparison to the pompous pair of windbags standing in front of us. The Right Honourable Mayor of Middleof, Sir Octavio Squigglebottom, and his latest wife, struggling with a yappy little dog on a bejeweled leash. When the doctor chose a life of adventure over the family tradition of governing Middleof, they held general elections. Possessing the most power, influence, and money, combined with the low IQs of the gullible citizens, the Squigglebottoms have ruled the island for the last 40 years.
Mayor Octopus, how perfectly dreadful it is to see you again. Still as orange as a Tasmanian tangerine, I see. You might think about staying out of the sun more. Ooh, and a new trophy wife as well. She must have set you back quite a bit. And her pet rat is what I mean.
Never mind that, Mecurio. Answer the question. Were you or were you not told to never peddle this product anywhere near or on or around the Isle of Middleof, especially at the bazaar?
But as you can plainly see, Lord Fartybody,
Squigglebottom,
Gigglebooty, I am complying with your request and not selling the product in question.
I was wondering, do you sell it by the case, your tonic?
Yes. Yes, I do.
You think me a fool, Mecurio?
Yes. Yes, I do.
I just witnessed you selling that man a case of the very product that you were told not to sell.
Ah, and there's the rub, Octagon. If you had bothered to read the label, you do read, don't you, Jigglesnoggin? No matter. As you can clearly see, the label reads New and Improved. The tonic, which of course you forbade us to peddle when we last met, was my great-great-great-grandfather's recipe, which contained viper heads. What we are selling now is my very own recipe, which I can proudly say contains zero viper heads and is gluten-free. Now, if you'll excuse me, dragons to display, potions to peddle.
Don't think for a minute that you're going to talk your way out of this, Mecurio. And let's talk about these so-called dragons of yours. I trust you have all the necessary paperwork and licenses for the display of dangerous creatures. I would hate to have to impound these things.
Since when does one have to have a permit to work the bazaar? My family
is no longer here. Like your dragons, you are the last of your kind. Things have changed here in Middleof, Mecurio, and the quicker you learn about that, the better. These creatures are too unpredictable to be allowed to just wander around our fine marketplace.
Ah, that's where you're wrong, Fluffernutter. Why, I can anticipate these creatures' every move before it even happens. Why, I can predict...
Before the doctor could finish his prediction, we all turned to see the mayor's latest trophy wife frantically pulling on one end of a jeweled leash with Precious holding on to the other end, rolling something around in her mouth.
Incendiary, spit that out this instant.
To our horror, the dragon spit out the leash alone. But after a minute, spat out the once fluffy little dog, now covered in thick, gooey dragon drool.
As I was about to say, I can predict that she was more interested in eating your pet rat's collar as opposed to the rat itself.
I'll have you know that was my wife's prize blue ribbon winning shih tzu.
Really? Well, I suggest she gets that looked at. Well, crew, our work is done here. And as it seems we are violating some type of ordinance, I suggest we pack up and take our leave. Squidbutt, always nice chatting with you. Mrs. Squidbutt, I hope you get your shih tzu together and your rat dried off. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patronage, and remember, do not take Red Dragon Tonic while operating heavy machinery. Come, people, let's take our leave. Let's get these dragons on board as quick as we can before our friend the mayor has time to stew and has all slapped in irons. And Percy.
Yes, sir.
Percy, I believe the cause of this current predicament once again falls into your lap. Really, Percy, it was such a simple task. And could you tell me what that task was?
To get the dragons fed before leaving the manor.
To get the dragons fed When I said that, I meant a chicken, or maybe a small ham, not the mayor's prize-winning chatsu.
In my defense, sir, I did keep her from eating the mayor's prize-winning wife.
Which is the only reason you're still in my employ. Probably would have given her a horrible indigestion. Well, enough chit-chat. Get the dragons on board and prepare to set sail. I want to be at the McMiggins compound by sunset. Evangeline gets a little trigger-happy after dark.
The thought of getting peppered with a load of rock salt from Evangeline McMiggins' ancient blunderbuss was not something I wanted to experience anytime soon. So, with little Ping-Ping wrapped across my shoulders, I quickly ascended the ladder to the ship, leaving Mecurio below, counting up the day's profits. Without warning, Ping wrapped her serpentine body tightly around my neck and let out a menacing hiss. I looked around to see what might be causing her distress and saw a strangely dressed man walking toward Mecurio.
Dr. Mecurio, I presume? I'm afraid the show's over for today, sir. Yes, I witnessed the performance. I wanted a bottle of Red Dragon Tonic. I'm afraid I've sold out, but never fear, we'll be back with more before you know it. Now, if you excuse me, the sky awaits.
Yes, I would imagine that you would want to leave quickly, before your miracle medicine's effects start to wear off and the townspeople you built try to decide whether to lock you and your crew up or have you all tarred and feathered. I myself purchased a bottle of your snake oil and found it to be no more than cheap whiskey, some cloves, and a touch of camphor. I'm afraid I'll have to ask you to keep that to yourself, sir, as it's a patented trade secret. And it's not cheap whiskey. It's moderately priced. I'm afraid I didn't get your name, sir. That's because I did not give it to you, doctor. But do not worry, I have no intention of pointing out your chicanery to the dim-witted townsfolk of Middleof. No, I am here to offer you a more substantial business proposal. One I'd hoped you'd be wise enough to accept. Well, I'm afraid that I don't find it wise to do business with a man who will not give me his name. Good day, sir.
My name is Wei Shang, and I wish to purchase the Frost Dragon from you. I'm the last surviving member of the Shang Dynasty, the true wardens of the dragon. But since I do not believe you are a man of honor, who would honor my family's duty in an honorable way, and you have cared for the creature so well, I'm prepared to offer to buy the dragon. Price is no object.
Well, I see. And there, as they say, is the rub, Mr. Shang, was it? Price is always an object, when the item in question is as priceless as our little Ping-Ping. The dragon's name is Pulau. Its power is the ability to alert one to danger and serve as a protector. I mean to take her back to China to fulfill her destiny and bring peace to our troubled lands. It is her fate. That's a lovely story it is, and I'm sure it's full of very mystical things and very much fun. And I wish you and your troubled country all the best. I really, really do. But I'm afraid Ping Ping's fate is to stay with her rightful owner, me. Now, if you'll excuse me,
I'm afraid I cannot take no for an answer, Doctor.
And I'm afraid that no is the only answer I have for you, Mr. Shang. But you know what? I'd be willing to go as far as to suggest that you do not want dear Ping to save China in the slightest. I think you want her to find the dragon hoard.
I'm afraid I don't know what you're talking about.
Yes, every child in China hears of the dragon's hoard at their mother's knee, a mountain full of gold and treasure, and most importantly, the Great Pearl, thought to be a source of unimaginable power. And you, sir, know good and well that only Ping Ping can open the way to the location of said riches. And you accuse me of chicanery indeed. Good day, sir.
And you, sir, what are your plans for the Pulau? I have it on good authority that your heart is failing and that a dragon heart replacement would allow you to live for 1,000 years. For that, you would sacrifice Pulau for your own selfishness. Doctor, I am afraid I can't.
Before you finish that sentence, Shang, I was wondering if you'd be so kind as to look up. That person with the cannon pointing directly at your noble head is my first mate, Lawrence Pettigrew. Now, not only is she a wonderful first officer and engineer, but she is also the cup holder for the East Scatterbury Cannoneers Club and can hit a bee in the buttocks with a cannonball from 100 yards away.
Begging your pardon, Dr. Mecurio, would you prefer if I put a cannonball in his stomach or just stick one in his gob?
It's a lucky day, Shang. She rarely gives anyone a choice. I would imagine sticking one in your gob would be child's play for her, but your choice, head or gut. Very well, Dr. Mecurio. We'll meet again. I'm sure we will, but I can assure you it won't be as pleasant as this time.
Dr. Mecurio's Mythical Marvels and Traveling Menageries stars the voices of Annamarie Macleod, Claire Whitaker, Star Haggen Esquerra, Ray Esquerra, and Ricki Vincent as Dr. Mecurio. To learn more how you can have dragons at your next party or event, please contact Dr. Mecurio at Dr. Mecurio page at thepuppetryinstitute.org.